else? Next. No one at the back who was a student? Are you? Which year are you in? Year 11.
I'm a homeschool student.
All right, homeschool student, okay. Anyone else at the back? Have I missed anybody? What about you? Mint?
Year 10.
Year 10, and what would you like to do? Economics again, okay, yeah. Anyone else? What about you, directly behind Krutoo? Yourself, yes. Huh? Okay, what would you like to do? Not sure. Which year are you in? Oh, fantastic. You should be grateful to your parents. Plan early. Very good. What about there? You can't hide. Come on, guys. Come on, guys. Don't start hiding. I'm only asking your name and what you want to do in the future. I haven't even given you any tests yet. That's later. Come on, don't hide. Yes. Yeah, John? What? Which year are you in? Year 10, okay. Right. Somebody sitting next to you, I believe, who's hiding. Yes. You're not sure of your name? You are year 10. You went straight to the last question rather than the big thing. Okay, guys, I think everyone has spoken, so good. Sorry, I have my teacher's hat on, so I like to get to know the students. Parents, you're important too, but I think from a teacher point of view, I like to know the students. Okay, so like I said, thank you very much for inviting me to talk about pathways to top universities, how to gain a competitive edge. I think we're living in a very competitive world right now in terms of getting into top universities. If you're looking to apply to top universities, not just in the UK, but anywhere around the world, whether it's the UK, US, Australia, or so on, then you have to plan. There has to be an academic planning, there has to be a career planning, there has to be a personal development planning. All those aspects are very, very crucial. So I want to talk about how to gain the competitive edge. I'm just to give you a background about myself, I'm from Malaysia, so I left Malaysia about, 16, 17 years ago to do my A-levels in the UK. When I was leaving, I was boarding on the flight, my mother said to me, and normally you would expect mothers to say, I'm going to miss you, I love you, call me when you get there, and so on. My mother said to me, you better do well, I'm spending a lot of money on you. You know, that was her parting message, right? She said, she was like, you better get to good university, you better do well, get straight A stars. So I was leaving the plane. I thought she was going to be like, I'm going to miss you. No, you better get the results. I think the point I'm trying to make here is this, that if you're aiming to go to top universities, and that is your plan, if you're academically good, and you're willing to work hard, you have that motivation, you have that desire to do well, then by all means, please, please, please aim high. Because A, you're paying a lot of money, right? As international students, most universities will welcome you with open arms because you're paying international fees, okay? This is recorded now, so they want you on board. Nobody will say no to you. They want you on board, right? The question is, challenge yourself to get into the competitive courses at top universities. If you're looking to go to LSE, Imperial, Oxford, Cambridge, UCL, KCL, all these medicine competitive in any 30 of the universities that offers medicine, Harvard, Yale, Stanford, all these universities is hugely competitive because obviously of their results achievement, their ranking, their traditional sort of the history and so on. So, what I'm trying to say is the amount of investment you're going to put into your education, right, it actually starts from now. The end point at the end of that journey, at the end of that education journey, you want to come out of it with fantastic, not just with fantastic results, but actually fantastic experiences as well. And that's one of the things you could gain by being amongst the best from all around the world at top universities. So what I'm trying to emulate from what my mother had said to me is that if you have the motivation and the desire to do well, your parents are not kidding you when they tell you to work hard, because that's actually very, very important. And it's extremely, getting very, very competitive. And I'll explain to you why is getting it competitive as we go along. Just a little bit about myself. My name is Yasmin. I was the science tutor of the year in 2011. I received my award from David Cameron. That's the award there. And when David Cameron shook my hand, he said, "Oh, you're from Wales. Congratulations." And I said, "I'm sorry, sir. I'm from Malaysia." His jaw dropped. So that was a very nice moment for me. In 2015, I won the Welsh Woman of the Year award. I sit on interview panel for medical schools. I won the Class Nobel Educator of Distinction in 2015. This is given by the Nobel family. It's not the Nobel Prize, unfortunately, but it's from the Nobel family. I was also a TEDx speaker in 2016, and I'm the founder of the UK's number one ranked school in the UK for the last 7 consecutive years since 2010. I started off the college from my conservatory. I was tutoring. I was doing home tuition and tutoring, and I started with 6 students, and it grew to 300 students over the span of 12 years. So I started off with no vision of making it into a school. I never thought when I started 12 years ago that I could make this into a top school in the UK. All I did was I just made sure that the students did the best and they got the results and got to universities that they want to go to. I'm no longer at Cardiff due to personal and professional reasons. It was a family unit. The family unit no longer exists, and therefore I've moved on to Oxford International College. So that just a little bit about myself. Okay, now going on to what do you need to enter a top university? Can you see this? Because I think it's a bit, I'm not sure the people at the back, could you see this? Probably you can't. Can I? I don't know. How do you? Because it's already enlarged in here. I'm very bad with technical stuff. No. Can we? In any case, enlarge it? Because I think it'll be. Yeah. Is that better? At the back, can you see? The last row at the back, could you see? Steve, can you see? You can see, okay. Okay, so what you need to enter a top university. Okay, before I talk about this, let me just tell you, how do universities come up with the criteria? How do universities decide what are the criteria they're looking for? The how they decide the criteria is based on what the employers are looking for, because at the end of the day, the end point after you graduate is employment, right? Unless you are a billionaire here and you don't need to work. But after you graduate, the end point is employment. So what are employers looking for? So let's look at that first. In 2012, Adecco report by CEOs and directors and board members, and this includes medicine, dentistry, engineering, law, whatever field you're looking to go into, what they came up with a survey, and they said, and this is what the universities have based their requirement based on this. Education qualifications, 35%. Work experience, 55%. Attitude and personality, 91%. Now, what I mean by 35%, it doesn't mean that 35% is the it's a low number and therefore academics is not important. No. What it means by this is academic is 35%, which means that you have to get the best results in academic to get your foot in the door. So they expect you to get 4 A stars. You have to get straight A stars. That is a given thing. But that is only to get your foot into the door. Once you got your foot in the door, then what else? They cannot base it on just academic results. Therefore, they're based on work experience, attitude and personality. And what I mean by attitude doesn't mean you go in and can speak very confidently. No, attitude in terms of substance, in terms of knowledge. So for example, if you want to do medicine, if you want to do engineering, economics, law, if you don't know what you want to do, then what have you done or what are you planning to do in terms of reaffirming your career choice and making sure that this is what you really want to do for the rest of your life? And if you don't do it now, for the students in the room, right? Mark my word, if you don't start it now, it's going to be too late by the time you start applying. Because if your aim, whatever you choose to do, right, whether you want to be a rock star, then aim to be the best in whatever field you want to go to. And for that, you have to plan earlier. Now, I'm not sure what planning you need to do to become a rock star, but I'm just saying, generally, whatever you choose to do, you need to aim for the best, okay? And that's very, very important. So these are the criteria that employers are looking for. Based on this criteria, universities came up with their decision factors. So I'll go back now to the other slide to look at. So that the reason why I told you what the employers came up with, so that you understand why are these the criteria the universities are looking for. So number one, excellent academic results in the right subjects. And also they look at your GCSE, they look at your AS results if taken. I will explain to you later on that some systems, there's linear and modular system. So there's linear for A. So some schools will not enter you for AS exams, some schools will enter you for AS, some schools will not. So universities will look at that differently. Predicted A-level grades. So these are all the academic side of things, right? GCSEs, AS, predicted A-level grades. So you need to get the scores. Rule of thumb, those of you who are in year 10, year 11, the rule of thumb is you have to get minimum 6 A-stars. I read my lips, yes, minimum. Minimum 6 A-stars, guys. If you want to go to top university, minimum 6 A-stars. I've repeated that 3 times. I hope that remains in your head. Okay, 6 A-stars, guys. Anything below 6 A-stars? Well, right. You can still try, right? Okay, right? So those of you in year 10, year 11, please, please aim for 6 A-stars. Anybody here in year 12? Anyone here who's in year 12? Okay, those students who are in year 12, if you haven't met the minimum 6, I hope you have, I won't ask you, I won't embarrass you. Right, so if you have met the 6 A-stars, brilliant. If you haven't met the 6 A-stars, I am not saying the journey has ended, I'm just saying the journey is tougher. Okay, right, it's tougher. Those of you who are in year 10 and year 11, please get 6 A-stars and above. It makes your life much easier when you're applying for university. There's one boy here in year 8? Year 8? Yes. Please aim for that and more. Because by the time you apply, young man, it will be much tougher, right? By the time you apply, I don't know what's going to happen. By the time my son applies to university, God knows what it will be. My son is only 4 years old, so it'll be. I mean, as it goes along, it's getting tougher and tougher. And do you know the reason why it's getting tougher? Do you know who to blame? Why is it getting more competitive? Students in the room, do you know who it is to blame? Why is it getting more and more tougher to get into university? Sorry? Requirements? Yeah. Yeah. Any other reason? I'll tell you why. It's the parents. The parents have worked very, very hard to make sure over the last 50 years, parents have worked very, very hard to make sure that the kids have very good education, are given all the support. We are driving education like no tomorrow, and because of that, competence has risen. So blame your parents for this, okay? And this is a global phenomena. It's not just Thailand, it's not just Malaysia. Hong Kong is a global phenomena from Africa to Middle East, to Asia, Southeast Asia. Education is prime now, right? And parents understand that, and therefore parents do everything to make sure that the kids, and because of that, competition is so stiff. Never in the history of education it's been this stiff. My father's a dentist. When he went to KCL, King's College London, you only needed a C grade to get into dentistry. A C grade is all you need to get into dentistry. Now anything below A star, you can forget it, right? I mean, and that is how competitive it is, okay? And because it's getting very competitive, the last 10 years, universities have said, okay, we've got the GCSE, we've got the AS, we've got the A-level, but it's not enough. We need something more. So what did they come up with? They came up with admissions test. So now, in addition to your GCSE, in addition to your AS, in addition to your A-levels, you need to sit entrance test. There's an entrance test for almost all subjects. So the boy who's in year 8 and the young boy there, if I was running a school from year 7 onwards, I will start teaching admissions test from that year. Because admissions test is aptitude, is very tough. It's beyond the curriculum. It's supposed to separate the well-trained from the well-brained. Okay, because you can train students, but you can't, you know, you can't brain them because it's whatever they have. So it's very important that admission test is now becoming really important now. So, for example, economics. If you want to apply to Cambridge for economics, you have to set a test called ECAA. If you want to apply to Oxford for economics, it's called TSA. If you want to, LSE does not have entrance tests at the moment, but by the time you apply, it might change. Engineering. Somebody said engineering. There are three entrance tests for engineering. PAT for Oxford, ENGAA for Cambridge, and STEP. For Imperial, okay? There are three entrance tests there. So all the top, any lawyers in the room? If there's nobody said law, but if you want to do law, there's LNET and there's Cambridge Law Test. So there are entrance tests for all, and there are different entrance tests for different universities. So it becomes even more complicated, okay? So number one, academics. Number two, admission test. Both things are important to get your foot into the door. Once you got your foot in the door and you're in the room with the admissions tutor, what's next? Commitment to your subject, knowledge beyond your A-level syllabus, and your personality. That's very, very important. The extra edge that you can offer, your passion. You know, if you want to be a doctor, why do you want to be a doctor? Is it because your mother is a doctor, your father's a doctor? That's not good enough. Why do you want to do economics, finance? I want to make lots of money. I mean, that's just not right. You can't just answer in the simplistic manner. I asked my son, you know, I mean, why you want to be engineering, you know, or why you think you want to do? Because I like to build Lego blocks. You know, you can't answer in that sense. You have to give real in-depth substance, and you don't have to be an extrovert to do well in an interview. You just need to have substance. You have to have knowledge, and that's very important. So you have to demonstrate all three elements in your application. Okay, now, how can you gain a competitive edge for top universities and beyond? The three pillars of success: academic excellence, career, university preparation, personal development. You must plan all three. You must plan, what elements do you need for academic excellence? What elements do you need for university preparation? What elements do you need for personal development? You have to plan, and you must plan early enough so that when you apply to university, you've got everything surrounds you that you're able to assimilate that when you apply, when you are sitting in front of the interviewer. You really want to be the person that the interview says to you, you know what, you don't have to fight for this. I would like, you know, they want you. You want to be the person that they say, wow, I really want to have this student. University interviewers are not out there to catch you. They want you to come to their university. However, you have to really shine and be the person that they really want to teach. If you can't shine in that interview, there is no way, if you can't impress them, and I don't mean impress by being an extrovert, by the way. I mean, you don't have to. You can be very quiet and calm. You don't have to be outspoken. Right? You don't have to. Some people have this image that to be good in an interview, you have to be very boisterous and very communicative. No. Communication is about substance. You have to have knowledge. Okay? So if you don't have knowledge, you can't answer the question. Simple as that. So if I ask in the room, why you want to be a doctor? Why do you want to be why do you want to do economics? Why do you want to be a lawyer? Why do you want to be an engineering? What would be your answers to those questions? I had a student, I was in an interview panel who, there was a boy who applied from, Mauritius. Yeah, he was a brilliant student, fantastic student on paper, had brilliant results, fantastic teacher references, everything was brilliant. He came to the interview, and the teacher's reference said that he even met the president. He was, you know, best student in the country, I think it was, yeah? It was so good. It was like so, you know, we were so excited to see the student. He came, he sat down in the interview chair, and then the first question we asked was, why medicine? His answer was, I would like to be a doctor because my father's a doctor, my mother's a doctor, my aunt is a pharmacist, my grandfather was a biochemist. That's why I know everything about medicine. We were like, okay, fine. So we tried to help him a little bit more, and we said, okay, why would you like to be? Okay, we understand you come from a family of all doctors. Brilliant, fantastic. But why do you want to be a doctor? So he took a few more seconds to think about it, and then he said, his answer was, I would like to be a doctor because my father's a doctor, my mother's a doctor, my grandfather's a doctor, and all sorts. Okay, anyway. So we thought, okay, maybe he's nervous. You know, maybe he's just nervous. He learned his answer. Maybe he doesn't know how to say it. Okay, never mind. We'll try to help him. So my colleague said to him, he's a doctor, he said to him, okay, I'm a doctor. I have 3 children. They hate the fact that I'm a doctor. I'm never home. I'm always busy. You know, why do you want to do medicine? Okay, so then he took a few more minutes. He sighed. And then he took a deep breath, and then he answered, I would like to be a doctor because my mother's a doctor, my father's a doctor, my grandfather is a biochemist, and so on. Well, can you guess? Did he get an offer or rejection? Of course. There was no substance to his answer. He learned the answer to a question, and he wasn't moving, not budging. Right? So this is why lateral thinking skills are very important. The ability to think on your feet, that's where personal development comes into play. Right? Without the personal development, you can't answer these questions because it's not textbook. There's no textbook. They can ask you anything in an interview. Right? They can ask you, you can't tell. And therefore, you have to be prepared for whatever comes your way. So personal development is very important once you have dealt with the first element, and that is academic excellence. Okay? Right. So strategic approach. Develop your plan. Think. Reflect. Consult the experts. Okay? Select the right combination of A-level subject and achieve the top grades. Okay, for example, for medicine, do not do maths and further maths because it's counted as one subject. For economics, do not do economics and business studies. It doesn't give it a breadth and depth. For engineering, make sure you do maths, further maths and physics. Okay, right? Make sure you know what is a tier 1 subject, tier 2 subject, tier 3 subject. Do not do tier 3. Try to do all tier 1. If you can't do all tier 1, at least do 3 tier 1 and 1 tier 2. Do not do tier 3 at all. Okay? So those you need to make sure you take the right combination of subjects. Okay, what are the typical offers? This is incorrect. The typical offers now are A star AA to A star A star A. The time you apply, it might be straight A stars. Okay, but the typical offers at the moment is A star AA to A star A star A. That's a typical offer to get into a top university. So we're missing one A star from this bit here. Explore your subject. Read, observe, research. Very, very crucial. Personal, this all comes under career preparation. Thoroughly prepare for your preferred university, entrance test, personal statement, interview. Grow and develop as a person. Maturity, courage, self-awareness, communication, leadership skills, attitude. Remember the 3 things they're looking for. Academic excellence. Yeah, admission tests, career planning, and C, personal development. The first thing that will get your foot in the door, academic excellence. Once you got your foot in the door and you sat on the chair, you have to be able to demonstrate personal development. So all 3 elements, very important. Different weightings, obviously. First thing is academic excellence. Without it, nothing counts. If you don't get the grades, doesn't matter, you have the right attitude if you don't have the academic ability. Okay? So that's crucial. Okay. In order for you to prepare for all these things, you have to choose the right schools. So choose the right school. Don't think school. Think university and beyond. Do not think just about the school. Think about the end point and work backwards. I give you an example. My son is 4 years old. In order for me to plan for his education, I have to think the end point. What is the end point? And I have to work backwards. So don't think moving forward. Think, just try to join the dots moving backwards. What is the end point? And then you plan. Does that make sense? Yeah, so that is very, very important. Now, what do you need to consider? Qualifications. There's school that offers A-level, there's school that offers IB, pre-U. What suits you the best? Remember, there's certain elements of, for example, IB requirements in certain areas are perhaps much higher than A-level. Pre-U is very new, so that's not completely understood. But A-levels and IB is the norm, right? So make sure you choose the right qualification for you. Now, within A-level, there is category within the qualification. A-level has 2 categories, linear and modular. If you're doing A-levels in Thailand, it's linear. If you're doing A-levels in England, it's linear. If you're doing A-levels in Wales, it could be modular. Because Wales, in Wales, the Welsh government have the modular system. In England, is linear. So the modular system, basically, I'll explain in great depth in a minute. I'll write on the board in a minute on that. The third thing you have to make sure the school looks at is the school offers career curriculum and university preparation. Make sure your school has that. Make sure your school offers personal development program. And I don't mean personal development just, oh, go for some sports or go and do some music. That is not personal development. Those are extracurricular activities. Do not confuse ECA with personal development. Do not get confused. ECA is something you've been doing since you go to nursery. Yeah, you go to nursery, since nursery, your parents have been taxi drivers, taking you to piano classes, taking you to karate, taking you to taekwondo, taking you for, am I right, parents, right? We're all taxi drivers, taking our children everywhere for all sorts of classes, right? You've done ECA since you are nursery, and the skills that you learn from ECA are things like teamwork, things like leadership. You learn all those skills from the time you are in nursery. But the time you reach to A-level stage or GCSE stage, you have to hone those skills into what we classify as personal development. You have to hone that. You have to move beyond just what you've learned in ECA. So those things are very, so don't confuse the two things together. Okay, personal development programs are things that hones your passion, things that hone what you combine your passion, you combine the supercurricular activities with extracurricular activities. You combine the skills together to hone, to understand what you want to do next in life. That is what personal development is. It's not just about going to classes and learning taekwondo and learning piano. It's not about that. It's about honing them so that you can use that for your future career. Okay? Now to explain about modular and linear. By the way, if you have any questions as I go along, because you may forget at the end, by all means, please put your hands up and ask me questions. I prefer that way rather than at the end you forget about them, okay? I don't really want this to be like a lecture style, so please do ask questions if you have any. So far, am I on board with everybody? Is everybody okay with what I'm saying? Yes? Okay. So just to explain in terms of linear and modular, so that you understand linear and modular. Can I just hold this? Yeah? I can hold this in my hand? Okay. So just to explain what happens in modular and linear. So in Wales, okay, so in Wales, you have 40% in AS and 60% in A2. So if you don't do well in your AS, you have the opportunity to resit. Okay? But the problem with that is, if you're applying to top university and you're resitting, that's not very good. So really, the resit advantage is no longer an advantage. It's not really an advantage because if you're applying to top university, it doesn't count. But 40% AS and 60% is an A2. That happens in Wales, okay? In England, okay? In England, 0% in AS and 100% in A2. So modular exams, considered to a certain extent, perhaps easier, allow opportunity to resit modules. Linear exams is more rigorous. Resits are not possible, considered to some to be a better preparation for higher education. And also, the beauty of the linear exam is the A2 module is a repetitive of the AS. It's repetitive. So what you learn in AS is repeated again in the A2. So really, you can spend your time in AS to work on career curriculum. So in OIC, what we do is, in the first year, we concentrate on the AS, we concentrate on career curriculum, and we concentrate on personal development. We concentrate on number two and number three in the first year, as well as the academic. In the second year, we concentrate more in terms of the academics because it makes sense for us to do that. Because in A2 is just a repetitive of the AS. Whereas this one is 40% and 60%, which the only advantage is allows you to resit. So it's considered, in some respect, to be lesser rigorous than perhaps, although the universities do accept all. They accept all systems, whether it's modular or linear, they accept it. But it's just like CIE. All of you doing CIE? CIE, Cambridge International Exam, you're all doing linear. You only have one attempt at your exam. So it's exactly the same in England. The reason why there's a difference is because England and Wales have a devolved government. So because of politics. Again, it's all down to politics. Okay. One of the reasons why I left Cardiff was because of politics. I thought I'd leave the politics behind and move on to OIC. But this is just to give you an example. Any questions on this so far? So there's different exam boards. So CIE is linear, WJEC is modular, OCR is linear, Educast is linear, Edexcel is linear. So the only exam board which is modular is WJEC. If you were looking to apply to, say, NUS, National University of Singapore, or Hong Kong U, or National University of Singapore, Hong Kong U, and CU, probably makes more sense to do linear. Okay? UK uni, because of this linear and modular, that's why universities look heavily at entrance tests, because it's very hard to compare students. So some schools in England, you do not sit any exams in AS. Some schools will not enter you for AS exam. Some schools will. At OIC, we enter you for AS exams. Okay? But we concentrate the time a lot on career curriculum and personal development. The AS exams in AS in England does not count towards your A-level. So your first year can be used for these two elements. Because the second year is just repetitive of the first year. Any questions? No? Oh, I'm good. I'm very good at explaining them. Thank you. Okay. Right. Okay, A-level reform. Right, this is what I was just saying. So for many years, GCSE and A-level subjects were taken as modular. So before this came up, the system, it was modular. So 50% in AS, 50% in A2. Now that's changed. Now it's AS is 0% in England and 100% in A2, whereas Wales, the only exam board, the only one exam board is WJEC, which means that when you get your results, if you do WJEC, you're only compared within the cohort of students who do WJEC, and it's only in Wales. So it's not very hugely comparative with the whole of UK. So in years to come, this might be a problem. But that's not my issue. They will have to deal with that later on, okay? Okay, so does this make sense? Do you understand the system? Yes? Any questions?
I have a question.
My
son is in AS in Cardiff.
Oh, right, okay.
He's doing good.
Yeah.
You say that because of the linear system, allow you only do it in A2 for
yeah. Yeah.
For instance, you say you need A-star, A at least, right?
Depends on the course. So if you're doing medicine, the offer is normally A-star, A-star, A. If you're doing economics, it's the same. I think engineering is the same. I think if you're doing humanities, then it's A-star, A-A, depending on the subject.
Get A star, A star, A.
There's no A star in AS. There's only A's.
Okay.
There's only A's. There's no A star in AS.
And then also you cannot switch, let's say like you take first year for modular system in Wales.
Yeah.
And then you move to UK system.
England. Yeah, you can switch because the linear is only in the A2 year. So it allows you to switch.
So switching means switching school.
Switching means switching school and switching exam boards. But when you switch exam boards, you cannot carry anything from Wales to England. You cannot carry anything.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's WJEC and England. What happened was the previous government, they for years the system was the same. Like Scotland have their own system, right? Scotland is different from England. But England and Wales for years was the same. Now is separated. I think over the years to come, it will cause quite a big of, it will cause some concern, I think. I'm predicting that may happen. Because it's a very uncomparative way. That is why the university are saying, because we cannot really decide, we cannot look at everything, we're going to give the highest weighted factor to entrance test. So entrance test is so important. Yeah. So, does that answer your question? Yeah. Any other questions? No? No. Okay. So choosing the right school, again, like I said, why admission tests are becoming increasingly important as a selection tool. Top GCSE grades do not guarantee top A-level results. So, like I said, what was the minimum result that I say, students? What was the minimum results you have to get? Minimum. Yeah, I really hope you don't go home tonight and say, I only have to work for 6 A-stars. I was on to 10 A-stars, but Yasmin say I only have to get 6 A-stars, so I'm only going to work. I'm saying minimum 6 A-stars for you to be looked at. Look, when you apply to universities, they'll put you into 3 piles. Pile 1, I really want you. Pile 2, I'm not sure. Pile 3, forget it. Which pile do you want to be in? Right, you choose, you decide which pile, okay, right? Now, and pile 3, they just leave it near the shredder. So, you know, you don't really want to be in pile 3. Pile 2 is question mark, not sure. We'll have to think about it. But pile 1, yes, let's invite them for interview. Let's get them offer. Let's do this, let's do that. So it's entirely up to you which pile, okay? Right, so top GCSE grades do not guarantee top A-level results. So just because you got 10 A-stars doesn't mean that's it. So those of you, work hard to get 10 A-stars, right? As soon as you get your 10 A-stars, on the day of results day, when you get your 10 A-stars, be very happy, go out and have a party, ask your parents for whatever you want, okay, right? However, switch back straight away, guys, because the journey hasn't ended, it just started, right? A lot of people always say to me, for the last 12 years when I was running the college, Cardiff Sixth Form College, When on results day, a lot of people say to me, oh, you should be very happy, you should go and have a party, and you should go and have fun, and, you know, enjoy, have all the staff, you know, you should take the staff for a treat and everything. And I always say to people, that's very true, but you know what, my body clock switches back straight away after the result comes out, because I know I have another year, I have another batch, another challenge. And that's how you got to see it, because if you don't see it that way, success never comes to your way, right? I have never once, for the last 7 years, we've been topping the league table, and I've known Krutoo for the last 10 years. I have never once on results day have taken time out to just go and have the, you know, to sort of thing. Because on results day, it's very important to switch on. The journey hasn't ended, it's just begun, okay? So it's very important to understand that. Standalone AS are less reliable. Because of this system, they cannot use the AS results anymore to compare the students. They cannot, because the system is so different. Because in Wales, WJC is used by all the state schools. All the state schools in Wales. And the and private schools, they can choose linear. So if Cardiff wanted to, which I have said to them, they should go to linear, but I don't think they are. So the state schools, so it's very hard to compare, especially your overseas student, you are compared differently from government state students. So it's very, very important to have that. Predicted grades and teacher references may be inaccurate, okay? That is why admission test is very, very important. So medicine, you have UK CAT and BMAT. Economics, ECAA, TSA, mathematics is STEP, MAT, engineering, law. Even universities in Thailand are asking for BMAT. Singapore is asking for BMAT. Sim University in Melbourne is asking for LNAT. So global pathways, all the top universities around the world are looking at entrance tests. It's very important you prepare for this. This is very tough. They're very tough tests. Okay, they're not easy. At OIC, we do 6 hours of preparation every week on entrance tests. And I'm very fortunate, I'm working with a team of staff who have come from Oxford University, Cambridge University, that allows me to be able to develop the program so that they get lots of help. But this is becoming single-handedly, this is becoming one of the most important factors in decision-making at top universities. So please, you know, if I had a school from year 7, I would start teaching that from year 7. Obviously not to the I can see that boy there on the back saying, oh my God. Okay, yeah. Okay, now, what are we doing at OIC? So strategy is everything at OIC. In Cardiff, I designed, my philosophy was Eastern and Western philosophy combined together to create the academic excellence. At OIC, I have enhanced what I've delivered in Cardiff previously, and the enhancement is in the form of global Pathways curriculum. Global pathways, that means that students, when they come to our college, we are helping them to apply to not just UK universities, but also universities outside the UK. So if somebody wants to be an engineer, our aim, our strategy would be to help you to apply to Oxbridge, Imperial, Caltech, MIT. We have an MIT professor who teaches at OIC. So we prepare students in terms of both global route. We're calling the global route. So it doesn't have to be just UK universities. So US universities, Hong Kong, Singapore. So there's a specific strategy. Whichever university you choose to apply, we work out an ideal strategy to maximize your chances. That is the new vision at OIC. There are three strands of what we're looking to do, and these are the three strands that universities are expecting. Academic excellence, about 90% of the teachers have all come from Oxford University and Cambridge University. What you must understand is OIC started in 2002. Dr. Mario Peters is the owner of OIC, very good friend of mine, and he built it on the basis of one-to-one. He didn't build it as a school. He built it as one-to-one sort of system. Now, I've known him for 3 years. In the last 3 years, I've been building the school towards making it into what Silom College used to be when I first started. It's a much smaller school. It's about 100 students in the school. We're selecting only 50 students for each year. So I'm much happier doing that on a personal level, because I'm the kind of person, and Krutoo will tell you, I know all my students' name, I know what they do, I know which grades they've got, which universities. You can ask all my alumni. Unfortunately, I haven't had very little interaction with the AS. The A2, I know them very well, but the AS, I think I only saw them the first meeting, and then after that, I sort of left after that. So I didn't have much interaction with the AS, but the A2s I do. Academic excellence is something that underpins OIC's sort of vision. We are making sure that the students get the right support from day one. Career university preparation, again, there's a career planning. So you're doing 40 hours a week. In that 40 hours a week, you're doing 7 to 8 hours per subject, and then you're doing 6 hours of entrance test. And we also have a bridging course. The bridging course is run by Oxford University mentors. So basically what they're able to do is you're able to learn personal statement, interview techniques, entrance tests, and as well as involve in research projects. Also work experience also is very important. So we're offering work experience to all the students. Personal development, so you've got critical thinking, philosophy, effective communication skills, leadership skills, debating skills, extracurricular activities. But it's not just done in the sense you go for your sessions and that's it. What we do is, this is a very much like career counseling. You come in for these sessions and we hone it into a package that will enable you to deliver it when you go for your interview or when you're writing your personal statement. That is key. And that's what the Oxford University mentors will be doing with their students on a weekly basis, 2 hours every week on that element. Can I just say this? I have never been ever stimulated in my life since I have come to Oxford International College. And I'll tell you why. Everybody there is of high caliber. Oh, thank you. That's very sweet of you. Thank you very much. Everyone there is of very, very high caliber. Even the receptionist at OIC is an Oxford University graduate. I walked into the college one day. I was going into the office, and the receptionist, a young lady from Oxford University, she was debating, they were debating with a student, a sixth form student, on politics. And I was so amazed with the intellectual debate that they were having. I was thinking, oh my God, I just stood there listening. And I thought it was so stimulating to be in that environment. That was fantastic for me. I have never been highly stimulated ever before in my life, because here, there's environment of so much academic talent. It's unbelievable. And OIC never pursued that route of that, because his concept was one-to-one, you know, sort of rather than having into school. Now we are turning it into a school sort of aspect. So career passion at OIC, bridging courses, career development, competition research projects, EPQ. EPQ stands for Extended Project Qualification. So through your Oxford University mentors, through the bridging course here, the Oxbridge mentorship, you will have the opportunity to do EPQ. EPQ means you'll be writing a dissertation, an essay, 5,000 words on anything that you have an interest in. You can then use that as your research project, and how many 17-year-olds could say that they've done some research and you can present it at your interview? And that is fantastic. I want you to be like one of my students, Kelvin. His brother is at OIC. And Kelvin, when he went to Imperial for his interview, the admission tutor said to him, "You don't have to sell yourself to me. I would like to sell my university to you." At the end of the interview, that's what the admission tutor said to him. He came back afterwards. He said, "Miss Sawa, does that mean I got an offer? I got rejected." I said, "You're an idiot. Of course you got an offer." He graduated from Imperial. He's now working. And I want you to be in that position, because that is the greatest feeling ever. Work experience in the UK and overseas, university preparation curriculum, interview, entrance test, personal statement. My very OIC's vision, which is something that I have enhanced based on my work of 12 years of work in education, is something along the lines of making sure that there's a strategy for every child. And with a very small environment, I'm able to do so. The Goodwill Ambassador Program and Mentorship Program is in Malaysia, so that is something that we do. So those of you who are in year 12, there's an opportunity to do so if you are wanting to go into that program. It's an Oxbridge Mentorship Program and work experience. Students can, whatever field you want to go into, you will have work experience during the day, and then you will have during the evening, you will have the mentors helping you to write your personal statement and interview as you go along your work experience. I don't think there's any other program like this anywhere else. So this is fantastic to have the mentors with you, helping you as you go along your personal statement and so on. So it's as you go along your work experience. Okay, this is something that's starting this year. We've always done GAP for the last 12 years, but this is something we're starting this year with the Oxbridge mentorship. It's a 2 weeks course or 3 weeks course. And we can give you more information on that if you wish to. You can join this even if you don't have to be a student at OIC to join this. You can be student of Krutoo to join this. You can, definitely, and you can join this in year 11 or year 12. Okay, it's a great program to have on board to help you with the work experience, personal statement, and interviews, and university entrance test as well. Oxford Summer Academy, they have a summer school. This is a great summer school where you can have major and minor. So you can choose major in law and minor in politics. You can choose a major in physics and minor in psychology. Major in philosophy, minor in photography. There's a major and minor concept. This is held in an Oxford college. Oxford University College is held there and is taught by Oxford University mentors and tutors. And it's a really good program, really good summer school program. And I love this one because the major and minor is great. You can do major in economics, minor in sport, as part of your extracurricular. You can choose major and minor. Economics and maths, literature and medical biology. I think no other place offers this major and minor combination. So if you are interested in this, this is something that you may want to look at. Okay, so any questions so far? No? Just two more slides, guys. Ty, could I have the brochures out? So maybe you could. There's just two more slides left, and then I'm open to questions after that. Okay, 21st centuries, global opportunities, global competitions. Are you ready for the race? For the students in the room, are you ready for the race? Yeah, you can give them out. Yeah. Push yourself out of your comfort zone. Okay, guys, this is your comfort zone, this is your learning zone, and this is panic zone. Okay? Now, if I ask you to come up here and dance in front of everyone, you will probably be panicked. I do not want you to go into panic zone. Panic zone does not create anything. For you. It does not establish anything. You don't learn anything from a panic zone. What I want you to do is come up from your comfort zone to the learning zone. And the only way you're going to come out into a learning zone is if you embrace the challenge. You have to embrace the challenge, remove the self-limiting belief. Do not think you can't do it. You must think you can do it and you will do it. I can give you stories of lots of students. Okay, let me tell you the story of two of my girls, two of my students who came to me. This is an 08. So when I first started the school, I had two girls from Hong Kong who came to me, below average students. Okay, in Hong Kong, HKC is out of 30, and they got 10 or something like that. They had very low results in the HKCE. They ended up getting all A's. In those days, there were no A stars. They had all A's, and they both went into dentistry and veterinary, two most difficult courses to get into in the UK. And now they've graduated, and they're doing so well. What I'm trying to explain to you is it was tough for them. From below average to get to where they are today, it was tough. But determination, remove the self-limiting, always aim for the top. Please, please aim for the top. Because if you aim for 100%, you could drop to 90%. If you aim for 90%, you will drop to 80%. If you aim for 80%, you could drop even further. So please, okay? Please aim for 100% because you don't know where you're going to end up with. Right? Okay? There's two things that make people successful. Either luck or hard work. Luck is not in your control. The only thing in your control is hard work. Okay? So use what is in your control. Because luck is not, you don't know whether you will have it or not. You know, you could win the lottery tomorrow. That's luck. Right? But that's not in your control. Okay? Be a captain of your ship. You're responsible for your learning. Be a captain for your ship. Very, very important. Okay? And last bit, I would like to show you this video, and I hope that you will learn from this video what it takes to believe in yourself, even if you have to be, if you have to look crazy in front of everybody. Believe in yourself, right? Health, passion. 16 years ago, if somebody said to me, you would have produced the best school in the country, I would have said, are you kidding me? Right, yeah? 16 years ago, I wouldn't have been able to say what's going to happen. I still don't know what the challenge is going to be. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but you got to be resilient. That is key. Resilience is key in all this, and you have to make it happen. Sorry, could I just... So, Ty, could you just help me with the video? I'm not sure why... And oh,
if you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. He must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling in his friends to join in. It takes guts to be the first follower. You stand out and you create ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. And it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. But for the next minute, you see the rest prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they get ridiculed for not enjoying it. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals. guns doing something great. Have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Okay, the sound wasn't great, but just to put into context, what it was trying to show you is this. You had that guy in the semi-naked guy who was out there dancing, and he took the courage to go up there and to dance, right? Yeah. And then you had the first follower, because he encouraged the other people to come and dance with him. You had the first follower who then joined him. Then after the first follower, then there was a third follower, then the fourth follower, fifth follower, and then they became a whole movement. The idea behind it is to show you the strength of leadership by taking ownership on what you do in your life. Okay? So take the ownership, and even if your friends are not working, if your friends are playing and your friends are not studying, if your friends are, I don't know, going out for a party or they are having fun or whatsoever, you don't have to be the same. You can take ownership on your life. If you want to go to top university, you can start a movement and all your friends will follow through. If you are with friends who are not, your peers are not gearing you or supporting you to go to top university, you could be different. You don't have to be the same. You don't have to play computer games just because your friends are playing computer games. You don't have to be the top in the... What is that game? League of Legends, is it? Is it called? Right, yeah? You don't have to be number one in that game just because everyone else... You can start something different. You can design a new Pascal programming. You can design a new program. You don't have to do what everyone else is doing. That's my key point here is. If you're motivated and you want to do well, then start and be different. That's basically what I'm trying to explain here. So I think I hope you gather that from today's session. I hope you've understood that. Is there anything, if you would like to ask me about personal statement or interviews and so on, please do so. If you have any questions about that, now I open the... to the audience, if you have any questions, please ask me questions. I've come all the way. I have to go back on a flight, so make it worth it. Any questions you have? Parents in the room, if you have any questions. Just to explain in context, OIC is only selecting 50 students. We're a very small college. There is no aim to grow the college in that sense, because Dr. Mario Peters is looking to innovate education in different ways, not necessarily in growing the number of students. So we're a very, very small college. So it's quite competitive to enter. And we're looking at four things: entrance test, aptitude, online testing, interview, and school report. We're looking at four things, basically. Any questions? There's also scholarships as well, if any students are looking at that. I have... for the students who are in the room and also the parents as well, if your child is not with you, that's fine. If it's possible, I would just like to get to know a little bit more about you. And if you ever contact me, if you want any advice on anything, it doesn't mean that you have to come to the school to get advice from me. By all means, Krutoo, I've been working with Krutoo for 10 years now. And like I said, I'm greatly involved in what he does and very supportive of what Krutoo does with the students. I'm happy to advise you regardless. It doesn't mean that you have to enter the school. If you want any advice on personal statement, interview, subject selection, you can always contact me. So if I could just ask you to please fill up this form so I get to know a little bit about you. Don't worry, we will not bombard you with information. I'm not here on a marketing journey. I'm here to support Krutoo, and I'm very grateful for Krutoo's support as well. So it will be great if I get to know a little bit more about you. If you can also put down what subjects you are doing and what is your career planning, and if you don't have any career plans, that's okay as well, just so that I know how I can help you in the future. Any questions while we're filling up the form? Any questions you have? Yes, yes. Great, one question. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay. The best way, if you're an introvert, like I said to you, I don't believe introverts need to change into extrovert. I don't believe in that, okay? I don't believe in introvert changing them to extrovert because it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen overnight. By the time you reach A-level stage, it's very hard to change introvert to extrovert. Okay, and I'll tell you a story of this young boy who came from Hong Kong. His name is Riemann Ho. He is the best, head boy I've ever had, okay? The best head boy that I've ever had in the college. Now, when he first came, he's an introvert, very quiet, okay? Very quiet. Now, I sent him for lots of work experience, lots of voluntary work. He did 6 or 7 weeks of work experience. He did voluntary work. He had mentors who were helping him. We were very small at that time. That time, CSFC was small. When you first visited us, it was a much smaller school. We did lots and lots of programs in terms of debating, effective communication skills, and all that. Now, if you talk to him now, he's a confident young man. He's not an extrovert, but he has a substance. He has substance to deliver. So the key point here is not to change somebody from an introvert to extrovert, is to make the introvert more confident and give them substance so that when they deliver what they want to deliver to others, they are more confident. Does that make sense? You can't change an introvert to an extrovert, but you can make them more powerful with knowledge. So having the knowledge, having that substance, and having that interest, they will develop that communication skills easily. And that is the plan at OIC. Similar. Sort of, that is the plan. The plan is through mentorship, to Oxbridge mentorship, through debating skills, through critical thinking classes, through philosophy classes, through just the engagement between the receptionist and the student. Yeah, that is conversation. That is communication. Any other questions? While some of you are filling up the forms, any other questions? Please give me as much details about your academic planning, your career planning. What are your aims? I would love to know more about what you plan to do. Yes. The Oxford Summer Academy. It's in. Do you have the brochure? It's there is at the back. There's a July, June, and July. For Goodwill Ambassador Program, if you're interested in Goodwill Ambassador Program, the details will be with Krutoo. If anyone wants to join the Goodwill Ambassador Program, that is 2 weeks or 3 weeks in Malaysia, work experience, personal statement interview, and entrance test. We're bringing Oxford University Oxbridge mentors with us. So basically what happens is, during the day, you go for work experience. During the evening, every day, you'll be helped to write your personal statement as soon as you've done your work experience. And that will be helped by Oxford University mentors. No questions? People at the back, do you have any questions? Come on, take the challenge, embrace the challenge, and ask a question. Do you want to know more about entrance test? No? Would you like to see some questions on entrance test? Yes, please, Krutoo. You're the only one asking me questions.
can you give an example to the audience about the debating class?
Okay. Do you want to know an example of debating, or do you want to know an example of how many hours and everything?
The debating
itself. Okay, so what happens in debating is we take part in competitions, debating matters and so on, and every week during the assembly, we will put into teams and you have to, we keep give you a topic and you have to discuss and debate the topics between the two teams. We also have critical thinking and philosophy classes, and that is again to get you to think outside the box. That is every week for 2 hours a week, every week, and in addition to the debating and effective communication classes. So the way it works is we put you into teams, and you have to discuss and debate and discuss different arguments, different discussions. And with critical thinking and philosophy, we actually teach you the theory, and then you have to learn it as you would normally learn a subject, an academic subject. We treat debating and we treat critical thinking and philosophy the same way as we treat biology, chemistry, maths. We treat it the same way. Would you like to see questions on entrance test? Does anyone want to try questions on entrance test? University entrance test? The parents look more eager than the students. Parents, I give you an advice. Please do not volunteer to try to do the entrance test. Please don't. It may not go in your favor. I'm helping you here. So would you like to see, guys, would you like to see the examples of entrance test? Yes? Okay. I thought so. Which one you would like to go for? There were lots of economic students. Maybe I try. So do you want to see the list of tests? BMAT, CAT, CPSQ, ELAT, HAT, IMAT, MLAT, OET, OLAT, PAT. Can you see those tests? These are all the tests. Oh, sorry. These are all the tests. These are loads of tests here. And this is not just the only test. You've got LNET, you've got loads of other, UK CAT. But for this website, these are the tests. I'm not sure if you can see that. Okay, which would you like to see? I'll pick BMAT. And you can see BMAT is not just for UK universities, it's for overseas university as well. Let's see if you can. There are three sections. Section one is aptitude, aptitude and skills. So let's try this. Oh, it's not very. Can we turn off the light? See if it if it's better. Is that worse? I don't know. But anyway, these are the style of multiple choice questions. Okay. Maybe I'll show you section three. Let's try one. Let's do an example. Parents, if you want to get in, if you want to be involved, you can be involved. Right. This is section three. You have to do an essay. Now, this is where, Pong, this is to answer your question about critical thinking, philosophy, and debating. Okay, right. There is no such thing as dangerous speech. It is up to people to choose how they react. Explain the reasoning behind this statement. Agree to the contrary that there can be instances of dangerous speech. To what extent should a society put limitation on speech or tech that it considers threatening? You have to write an essay on that. So this is why I suggested the parents. Some parents are like, what is this going on? Right. So for the students in the room, anyone wants to volunteer, take the challenge, embrace the challenge, be that nut who was dancing, be the first one. Other people will follow you. You are the leader. Who wants to be the leader here? Who would like to tell me? There is no such thing as dangerous speech. It is up to people to choose how they react. Explain the reasoning behind this statement. No? By the way, do you know what course is this for? BMAT is for which course? Sorry? Medicine. Okay, maybe do the second one. All right, okay, let's do the third one. That is easy. The third one is easy. There is money to be made from not curing diseases. Come on, this is easy. There is money to be made from not curing disease. What do you think is meant by this statement? Argue to the contrary. To what extent do you agree that there is money to be made from disease? There is money to be made from not curing disease. Come on, economics in the room. Yes. Yep.
And as you buy medicine, like the companies make money.
Companies make money, yes. Drugs, yeah, drugs. Okay. Any other point? Why do you think there's money to be made from not curing disease? How do we define disease? What is the definition of disease? Anyone in the room? Who was the two? There was a potential medical student, one person here. Can you define what disease is? By the way, can we give her a round of applause? She is the leader. Yes. Now we just have to have the follower. Come on. Any other statement? What do you define disease as? Anyone in the room? So would you say cancer is a disease? Yes? An injury? An injury is a disease? So if you get into a coma state, is that a disease? So the key element here, the key point here is disease, right? And there's money to be made from not curing disease. Pharmaceutical companies, yes, agreed. Drugs. Anything else? Anyone else or any, you know, who would benefit from not curing disease? And how do you make money from that? Yes. Yes, that's what she, yes, pharmaceutical companies. From an economical point of view, what do you think? Hospitals, right? Do you think economical point of view, do you think that is fair? Krutoo, can I give them a homework? If Krutoo would allow this, I know I'm taking so much of your time, so I won't go into this. Don't worry. Some of the parents are thinking, okay, we don't really want to be in a class. I'm sorry. For the students who are in this room, if you would like to do that essay, right, try to do that. Send it to Krutoo. I'm happy to look at it and give you my remarks, okay, for anybody who wants to make an attempt, okay? So shall we, is that all right? Yeah, if you would like to make an attempt, is that okay, Krutoo, or am I? Is that okay? Yes? So there is money to be made from not curing disease. If you think you can write something on that, please, it's not compulsory. You don't have to do it if you don't want to do it. But if you want to make an attempt to write it, please do so. Send it to Krupong. And I'm happy to look at it and give my remarks so you get an idea of how your thinking is. Guys, these questions is all about how you think. You know, what is the thinking process? What is the thinking journey? That's what they're looking for. Because I told you, the first thing they're looking for is by putting your foot in the door, what is the first thing they're looking at? Academic excellence. The next thing they're looking at is your thinking. Okay, just to recap, guys, just to recap, what are the three elements? What is the first thing universities are looking at? Students in the room, what is the first thing? Come on. I can't hear you. Can I ask the parents not to say anything, just the students? First thing, what are they looking for? Students? Who wants to be the leader this time? She was the leader last time. Come on. Yes. Academic excellence. Second thing, somebody else? Have you forgotten? Yes. Good, well done. Third thing. Well done. To get your foot in the door, first thing, what is very, very important? The only thing that's going to get you your foot in the door is what? Academic excellence. Then only you have to show extra edge beyond that. Okay? So that's very, very, very crucial. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed that talk. I hope that you've learned something, more importantly. And I really hope that all the students here in the room you really aim to get to top universities and aim high, whatever you choose in life, and be prepared, embrace the challenges. You can do it. It's proven over and over time. People have done things that they couldn't believe they could have done it, right? And that only comes from determination. And like I said, there's only two things that make people successful, either luck or hard work. You know, luck is not in your control. Hard work is. So that's all you've got to offer, right? Do it and get there. And like I said, minimum, what do you need at GCSEs? Yeah, but please do not go home tonight and put a poster and say 6 A-stars is what I need. Minimum. Remember the word minimum, big M. Okay? Right? So please look beyond that. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. If I could have the forms, if you have filled the forms, thank you very much. And I'm serious about this essay. If you would like to do it, please do it and make an attempt. And I'm more than happy to look at it. And it applies to all courses, not just for medicine. It just shows how your thinking style is. That's all. Okay? I'm still around. If you have any questions, by all means, I'm more than happy to talk to you. My colleague is also here, Steve. From OIC, he's also here. So if you have any questions to ask us, by all means, I'm more than happy. And like I said to you, please, if you want to contact me, contact me. It doesn't matter if you, if you're looking to apply or whatsoever. It doesn't matter. I'm here. Krutoo is a very good friend. I'm very willing to support in any way possible. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. 20 ปีที่แล้วนะครับเฟิลเตอร์อินเตอร์ขึ้นมาสองตัวสองตัวถูกด่าถูกว่าถูกชนะได้ไหนถูกพูดให้ท้อถูกพูดให้ถอยถูกพูดให้ให้เริ่มโมสถีแต่20ปีที่ผ่านมาวันนี้ที่นี่คือผลที่สุดถ้าเราเต้นเราคนเดียวที่สุดตีเขาเป็นคนเต้นตามตอนนี้ก็ปีคุณตู่จะเปิดช่วงกรุงเทพประมาณ100 กว่าเจ้าแล้วนะครับแล้วก็ทั่วประเทศ ตอนยี่สิบปีที่เราที่เปิดฟิลเตอร์อินเตอร์ตัวต่อตัวเนี่ยครับประเทศไทยมีโรงเรียนเซอร์แค่5 โรงแล้วก็เสียงด่ามีประมาณ1,000,000 วันนี้ประเทศไทยมีโรงเรียนเซอร์ที่จดทะเบียนแล้ว300 โรงแล้วทั้งหมดคือคุณภาพต่ำนี่คือสิ่งที่เราเต้นมาคนเดียวยี่สิบปีเมื่อกี้ดูวิดีโอเขาก็น้ำตาไหลเราก็น้ำตาไหลประเทศเราจุดบ้าแบบนี้มีคนหนึ่งประเทศไทยมีคนหนึ่งมาเจอกันนะครับ อันที่สองคือเราจะสอบอีกแล้วโอเคให้ก่อนแล้วก็อันที่สองที่คุณสุนทรพยายามจะพูดตลอดเลยก็คือตอนที่ไปประชุมที่เคมบริดจ์คำพูดเขาดีมากนะครับเขาบอกว่า200ได้100คือปกติ200ได้80คือโง่200แล้วไปต่อยอดได้120นี่คือฉลาดเพราะฉะนั้นเวลาที่คุณสุนทรสอนหนังสือเด็กหรือว่าให้ครูทำงานเนี่ยครับ พยายามเอม100อย่างเดียวมันไม่มีใครได้100หรอกยากมากแต่การทำงานน่ะคือทำ100ทำ100ทำ100ตลอดเพื่อให้เราได้เป็นคนปกติไม่ใช่คนโง่แต่เด็กจะไม่เข้าใจก็80ก็พอแล้ว90ก็พอแล้วไม่ใช่ไม่ได้ดูแต่คนโง่นะคำพูดก็ชัดเจนอยู่แล้วนะครับสุดท้ายก็คืออย่างล่าสุดคือประชุมที่นิวคาสเซิลเนี่ยครับสำหรับในทีมนะครับ ไม่ดูเซอร์ต้องเจ็ดนี้ไม่ดูเลตเตอร์เรคคอมเมนเดชั่นไม่ดูไม่ดูไม่ดูไม่ดูไม่ดูดูอย่างเดียวครับดูเจ็ดนะครับแต่ละออกเข้าอินเทอร์วิวเขาเรียกว่าเอ็นเอ็นไอมันติดมินิอินเทอร์วิวใช่ไหมครับเลยครับมีทั้งหมด7 คลาสนะครับ7 คลาสใช้ไซโคโลจิสทั้งหมดเลยคลาสที่หนึ่งดูว่าดูให้หมอหรือเปล่า ดู communication skill ดู mindset ของอยู่ดูวิธีคิดของอยู่แล้วตัดสินจากนักจิตวิทยาเลยว่าอยู่ก่อนจะมีมาดิซินไหม if yes you yes if no you no ไม่ต้องคุยเรื่องอื่นตอนนี้ระบบอังกฤษใช้วิธีนี้เกือบทั้งประเทศแล้วแม้แต่ออกสอบก็สถาบันใหม่แล้วยังเป็นเครื่องเริ่มแล้วนะครับอยู่ท็อปทันในใหม่หมดเลย only bond to be เท่านั้นคราวนี้เด็กไทยจะมีปัญหาอย่างที่หนักมากๆเลยคือ แม้แต่พ่อแม่ก็เป็นนะเป็นเยอะคือแยกไม่ออกระหว่างบอลชูบีกับ passion คือ passion เนี่ยวันนี้ลูกไม่ทำแค่เรียนลูกชอบคอมพิวเตอร์แล้วลูกไม่โฟกัสวิชาอื่นลูกชอบคือคอมพิวเตอร์แล้วลูกไม่ทำให้พ่อลูกชอบคอมพิวเตอร์แล้วสุดท้ายวันนึงเด็กล้มเหลวคอมพิวเตอร์มาหน้าแห้งทั้งแม่ทั้งลูกเลยไม่คุยไม่รู้เรื่อง passion ไม่ใช่ want to be want to be ไม่ใช่ passion top university ทั้งหมด looking for want to be ไม่ใช่ passion นั้นอันนี้คือเรื่องใหญ่ว่าที่ยัสมินพูดทั้งหมดเนี่ยคือ how to develop ตัวเองให้เป็นพบตัว want to be ครับอันนี้คืองานที่ท้าทายที่สุดและยากที่สุดถ้าเจอตัว want to be เมื่อไหร่ก็ success Thank you so much ขอบคุณมากขอบคุณยัสมิน
If you wish to come to the college, that's absolutely, I mean, by all means do apply. If you wish to come to the Summer Academy, that's absolutely open to you. If you wish to come to the Goodwill Ambassador Program, you don't have to be a student of OIC to be taking part in the GAP program. We're very, very flexible, very open. Our vision, my aim, my whole life, my whole 12, 16 years now has been in terms of education. And I'm very, very, you know, interested in developing students. My biggest fulfillment in life has always been when a student receives the offer. Students always say to me, for the 2 years they're with me, they always say to me, oh, Miss Awa, they always complain, you make us work so hard, evenings, weekends, so much things, you know, debating competition, this competition, that competition. They always say all sorts of things, but on result day, I get the most love by everybody and the university when they get the offers. Because it's great. Nothing beats that feeling. Because you either get two envelopes, guys. You either get an A4 size envelope or a B5 size envelope. Okay? The B5 size envelope will say, thank you very much for your application. Due to very high competition this year, unfortunately, we're unable to offer you a place. Good luck. Bye-bye. Okay? That's a B5 envelope. And literally, that's what they say. They don't tell you why. They just say, due to very high competition, we cannot give you a place. Good luck. We're sure you're going to do well at other places. Or you're going to have an A4 size envelope, which say, congratulations, well done. You've been given a conditional offer. This is the offer. This is the pack. Welcome. We're looking forward to seeing you. It's your choice, guys. B5, A4. You know, it's very, very important. You need to understand that. And for me, I love it when I see that the A4 envelope comes to the door and I know exactly what's written in there. By the way, the reason why I told you, because by the time you apply, you will change to emails. So that's why I told you. That's why I gave you it. Because normally I don't want to spoil that B5 envelope or the A4 envelope. I don't know. But by the time you apply, you will receive. And the worst thing is on the subject, they have already told about your application. And sometimes you get through your text message. Sometimes now you can see your decision on text message. So it's becoming more and more cruel, I think. You know, Oxford University, for example, they make their offers during Christmas time, and some students get their offers on Christmas Eve, or rejections on Christmas Eve. I think that's like the most cruel thing ever. But that's how life is. That's how competition is becoming. And I just want everyone to do the best they can and aim high. And like I said, and for those of you who are amongst peers who are not working, you can make the different movement. You can start a different movement like that nutty guy who was dancing. Okay? You can start to be different. Okay? And Cambridge University, Oxford University, want to have people who are different, unique, movers and shakers. So if you are the kind of guy, like a boy wants to consider science, yeah? If you're the kind of guy, you go home and think about programming, think about computers every night, that's fine, they love you, okay? You don't have to be the kind of boy who's playing football and playing at national level. You don't need to be that. They're not looking for that kind of person. Okay, if you want to play football at national level, go to a sports school, be the best in that, right, okay? But they're not looking. So if you're looking economics, those of you doing economics, how many of you read the book Freakonomics? Economic students, put your hands up again. Put your hands up. They were more economic. No, no, no. Don't die. I remember. Come on. Economics and finance. Business, finance, economics. More than one. One, two. There's more than two girls. Where are the boys? I'm sure there were boys as well. Finance. No? Only two girls. You decided to change your mind after I talk. You decided to change your career. After my talk, I made such an impact. Okay, so the two economic students who did stick to their careers, okay, read Freakonomics.
Freakonomics is the basics of understanding what economics is about. But do not mention that in your personal statement, because that is the basic thing. If you haven't read Freakonomics, you're not ready for an economics degree. So read Freakonomics, okay? Medicine, there's a boy who wants to do medicine. Right, read the book, The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. What do you think the book is about? What do you think the book could be about? The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. Why do you think he mistaken his wife for a hat? No? Think of a condition that made him mistake his wife for a hat. Alzheimer's, well done. Excellent, I like this book. Alzheimer's, yes. Okay, so start reading this book. Very, very important, okay? Start reading, stop looking at Twitter and Facebook and things because it doesn't bring you anything, okay? Read these books because it allows you. Let's go back to good old reading, okay? Good old fashionable, and that's why I love being in OIC because I'm surrounded by people who are always reading, which I think is great, okay? So read, read and read, but don't stop doing your, you know, things like Twitter and Facebook and things, because it's good, social media is good, but social media doesn't give you enough substance to have the information. Have the information, then go on social media. Okay, have the information first, okay? Seek to understand first before it being understood. If you want to be understood, you have to understand first. So understand what's going on around the world, read the books, read news every morning, okay? Understand what's going on, then go on social media, and then debate, and then discuss. Because you have the substance then, okay? Thank you very much. I've taken so much of your time. Thank you.